बी रेडी गाइज, 5 seconds, स्टार्ट. सर, देयर आर 3 फैक्टर्स कनेक्टेड विद इंडस्ट्रियल रिलेशंस. फर्स्टली सर, द मैनेजमेंट एंड ऑफिसर्स शुड नो द नॉर्म्स ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियल रिलेशंस. आई डू नॉट फाइंड एनी ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम फॉर ट्रेनिंग हाउ टू डील विद द स्टाफ और हाउ टू डील विद प्रॉब्लम्स एक्सपीडिशियसली. If they do not change their outlook, if they do not attend to the grievances in time, they will ultimately accumulate and create a grave crisis, and we shall again be falling in some trap, and strikes will become an annual feature, or there will be strikes many times. Secondly, sir, there are large number of unions. Last time a meeting was called of all the unions. There are craft-wise unions, station masters union, ticket collectors union, and so many others, and there is much scope for politicians and others to multiply unions because the occupations are 700 to 800. There are only 2 federations. The railways have not taken steps to eliminate multiplicity of unions. Unless this is done, there can be no concrete results. In order to make collective bargaining successful, I feel that the policy of industrial relations and industry-wise unions should extend to this. The scheduled castes and scheduled tribes want their separate union, and the tribal people also want their separate union in the railways. I feel, sir, they must be completely banned. There should be large industrial unions which can deliver the goods and which alone can create an atmosphere of good relations between the railways and their employees. Sir, the third thing I would like to suggest is that they must find out the bottlenecks. But there is no attempt. There is no wage policy. Today, the people belonging to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes are employed as contingent or casual labor in many places, and they are paid the wages which the collector in each district fixes. The contingent labor consisting of 2 or 3 lakh people at different places is paid 50% less than what regular employees are paid or what the All India pay scale is. They have been working for years and are getting different wages in different districts depending upon the minimum wage or the collector fixing the pay scales and wages in that state. Discrimination is very great. I would like the minister to look into the matter. The contingent labor should be paid at par with other railway employees. Sir, another point which is very important is about the promises given by the railways at the time of strike. A large number of people, when the interests of the nation were in danger, staked their lives there were on duty. Many were assaulted. At that time, a promise was given that their children or their dependents will get priority in employment. But instead of that, after the strike was over, many of them were assaulted. I would like to know from the Honorable Minister what happened to the promises given by him to the employees who were on duty, who staked their lives. How many people and how many of their dependents have been given jobs in the last 1 year? If the promises given to them at a crucial time are not fulfilled, the government will lose its credibility and the workers will not be able to do their duty properly and faithfully. I would like to say 2 other things for the sake of good and happy industrial relations. BOZIUM must go. In all the modern countries, industrial relations have become successful because the officers treat their employees on equal basis and informally. They help them to solve their problems. Therefore, the attitude of the officers in the railway administration will go a long way in improving the industrial relations in this vital sector of economy. I would also ask, why should the government or the railway administration feel shy in applying the Industrial Disputes Act to its employees? No reference has been made to it. Not a single question is referred for adjudication to the industrial tribunal or any machinery under the industrial law. Railways being the biggest transport industry, they should accept as a norm of industrial relations that their problems will also be referred to adjudication machinery available in our country. Small things like termination or suspension may not be very big or important from the railway administration point of view, but it is of vital importance to the individual employee who is suspended for months and years together and does not get any redress.
he has to rely upon the mercy of the deciding authorities. It may take 1 or 2 years. In the state from which I come, under the Bombay Industrial Relations Act, if a man is terminated from service or dismissed, he can go to the labor court and his grievances can be looked into within 3 months. Mr. Vice Chairman, sir, I would like to make a mention of some of the problems of the workers in general and those of the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in particular. Sir, in the first place, I would like to state that the Railway Administration does not provide to the workers a speedy and efficacious remedy against their grievances. If a worker is demoted, he has to go to the High Court after appealing to the executive authority. If a worker is superseded, he has to go to the executive authority in appeal and then to the High Court. If he is removed or suspended from service, he has first to go to the executive authority and ultimately a right is administered to him to go to the High Court. The result is that if a worker is dismissed from service, even though his dismissal is not proper or wrongful, he will not get the relief unless he goes through this channel of appealing to the zonal authority, then to the labor board and ultimately referring the matter to the High Court and lastly the Supreme Court. The result is that in a case where the judicial authority holds the termination illegal and improper, the railway authorities are required to pay back the entire wages. It is all right that we have removed and dismissed a large number of workers. I think they are in thousands. What is the outcome of this? The outcome would be that there will be a large number of cases in the High Courts and the Supreme Court. Ultimately, it would be seen that even if 1/4 of the workers get the relief of reinstatement and back wages, the Railway Administration will be required to pay to the tune of crores of rupees by way of back wages, and therefore the time has come when we have to consider afresh as to how our industrial relations should be. Sir, my friend has very rightly pointed out that under the industrial law, a worker can certainly after dismissal go to the court immediately and get his case adjudicated. That forum is available and that remedy is available. But that is not so in the railways. And I cannot understand what difficulty there could be if you provided a forum for speedy and efficacious remedy. Then the worker will also understand that his case is being judiciously scrutinized and he will feel that he has no case and he will not proceed ahead. But when he spends 1 year or 2 years before the adjudicating authority, he knows, and the Honorable Minister would also agree with me, that by and large the tendency is to uphold the order of the lower authorities, howsoever wrong, illegal, improper and malafide that order may be. That is the tendency, and ultimately when a judicial scrutiny is held, that order is set aside and the result is colossal loss which the railways are called upon to bear on account of their wrong policies. Therefore, my suggestion would be that it is high time to consider that the Railway Administration gave every worker a forum where he can seek the redress of his grievances without much time being consumed in between, and in that way it will be beneficial both to the workers and to the Railway Administration, and therefore this should be done. This is one of my suggestions. Secondly, sir, even though the Railway Administration has now taken a decision that all those who had participated in the strike but were not responsible for any sort of violent activities or sabotage or intimidation should be taken back in employment, I can say without being contradicted now that there are today hundreds of workers who have been removed from work and there is no charge against them, and that they have not done anything that would amount to intimidation or anything that would amount to doing something violent or involving violent action, but still they have not been taken in employment. I have myself represented some of the cases. I cannot understand why they have not been taken in employment, and therefore in all such cases there has been inordinate delay in taking them back. The Railway Board should now examine and find out who is responsible for the delay in the disposal of these cases. That is the responsibility of the railway board and of the general managers or the zonal managers or the divisional managers, whosoever were entrusted with the work of supervising the cases and taking appropriate action, and if they have committed lapses, they should be dealt with so that such a delay on the part of the railway administration would not be repeated.